No. sky.
Amen. I serve a prayer answering God. What about you? Amen.
Amen.
Amen. First of all, I want to thank you first for being here today, those that are in-house and those that have joined us on live feed alike. You can take a look around. You see there's several that are not here. We do have a few that are on the road traveling, some that are sick, just not able to be here. They've joined us on live feed, so let's continue to be praying for each one of them. Amen. I want to thank you also for allowing us the opportunity this last week. Left last Sunday, came back yesterday afternoon to attend the General Assembly 2024. These are great and wonderful times where we're having wonderful worship services. It's a great time to get to see some folks that we don't get to see, but once every, about every 2 years sometimes with some of these people. But the business sessions is a very important time where we're taking care of things within the church world and church community. These things do apply to us as a local church. There are some things that was passed, and you'll hear more about that later on, but we want to make sure that you're aware of what's going on. But I'll bring those out as soon as we get an edited version, because if you look at my book, it's just got a bunch of ink marks scratched everywhere, so it doesn't do us any good on that. But we want to take a moment this morning that we want to be praying for our nation. I don't care. I'm not asking political affiliations. I'm not, that has jack to do with anything this morning. To know that our nation and our country has gotten to the point where an assassin, I know that there's been plenty of those in the past, but we get to this point where we have an assassination attempt on a, whether you like him or not, but on a presidential candidate. This is not good for, this does not show well for our nation, amen? No matter what you feel, no matter how you feel, what matters is someone tried to take someone's life. A life was taken yesterday. I do still do not, as to my knowledge, still do not know the identity. Sure that there are some rumors about some names has been spit out, but there's not been confirmed by credible news medias. But we want to continue to be praying for this young lady that was killed yesterday due to a stray bullet. There was two men that was also killed, or excuse me, also wounded. Excuse me, there's two that was also wounded during the course of all of this. And then also the gunman, one of the gunmen himself was also killed. We need to be praying for these families, amen? We were sitting there in the living room, and Katie said that in 18 years of her life, there's been more historical events that's happened in her life, and she doesn't want to continue to have those. And I'll be honest with you, I'm ready for them to stop too. So a lot of things has happened in our nation and our country. We need to be praying for our country. We need to be praying for our nation. I will tell you with certainty, I have said many a times, the church world has begun to start getting quiet on a lot of things. But I will tell you, beyond a shadow of a doubt, Pentecostalism is still real. God is still God. The Holy Spirit is still moving. Amen. And after coming home from the General Assembly this last week, I can assure you, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that leadership of the Church of God, most leadership of the Church of God, still believes in the true Pentecostalism of the Word of God. Still believe in the holiness of the way we're supposed to live our lives. Amen? And that does make me feel a lot better. There's a lot of things going on in our church world. There's a lot of things happening in our denomination. We need to continue to be praying for those. But right now, I want to take a moment. We need to be praying for our nation. There's a lot of things that's going to happen over the next couple of months. I do not believe that yesterday's events are one and done. I believe that things are going to happen, whether it be against Donald Trump or it be against Joe Biden or against anybody else. These things should not take place, and we take a stand on that. Amen?
Amen.
If you would, let's all stand all over the house. Although that many of us have prayer requests. If you have a need, let it be known by lifting of your hand. God knows each need. But I'll take a moment as we begin to pray. We're going to pray for those needs. But I want us to start off and let's pray for our nation. I'm not praying for any particular person. I'm praying for God to touch the United States of America. We need God to move. If my people, which are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven. God will heal our land. That is talking about the United States of America. We need God to move. Amen? Let's take a few moments and let's pray for our nation. And then we're going to pray for the needs connected to this church. Dear Heavenly Father, as we come to you this day, God, I lift this nation. I lift America up to you. Father, I'm asking you to touch. I'm asking you to move. I'm asking you to minister. I'm asking you to touch in a mighty way across this nation. Father, you see those that would have this nation to fall. You see those that would have this nation to crumble. But I take a stand this morning, Father. I'm praying that you would move. I pray you would minister to this nation. I pray, Father God, that you would have this nation come back to you. I pray, Father God, that you would have this nation to humble ourselves. Let us pray. Let us seek you. Let us come back to you, Father. Our churches need to get back a hold of the mighty hand of the Holy Spirit of God. God, I'm praying that you would move and minister in a mighty way. God, you've seen the uplifting of the hands of each one, those that are in-house and on live feed alike. I pray, Father God, you would move and minister. You see those that are sick connected to this church. You see those that are need a special touch from you, Father. I'm praying right now that you would move and minister in a mighty way. Touch this service this morning. Allow your Holy Spirit to move and minister to the hearts and lives of each one here in-house and live feed alike. I pray, Father, you'll touch our praise team as they bring forth your word and song. I pray, Father, that you'll touch and minister in a mighty way. We forever give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen and amen. Would you give God a hand clap of praise this morning? Let's worship in song today. Amen.
Amen. Yes, let's sing praises. Let's sing, I Never Shall Forget the Day.
I never shall forget the day. on, church.
I know that God has the answer. Whatever's going on in your life, I know that God is able to move and God's able to minister. Whatever the need is, my God is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we could ever hope or imagine. Glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. God is able to move and God's able to minister. Church, would you just stretch forth your hands? Stretch with your hands this morning, dear Heavenly Father God, whatever the need may be. Yes, glory be to God. Whatever the need is, I know you're able to move. I know you're able to minister. I know you're able to touch. God, I may not know the very need. I may not know the very depth of the heart. But God, I know you're able. I know you're able to move. I know you're able to minister. I know you're able to touch, Father God. God, God, move right now. God, touch the very table of the heart right now, Father God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Heavenly Father God. God, minister right now, Father God. Yes, glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. God, you're worthy of praise. You're worthy of honor. God, the very table of the heart right now, God. God, minister in a mighty way today, God. Glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your blood that you've shed on Calvary. Thank you for your blood, Father God. Father God, right now you see the needs that have come across on Facebook, on social media, on the prayer wall, Father God. I pray right now that you would move. I pray you would minister. God, minister to each of these needs in the altar this morning. Father, those that are on the prayer wall, those that have come across on social media right now, Father God, touch and minister right now in a mighty way. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, God. Move right now and minister right now, Father God. You see the prayers that have been prayed, Father God. God, I'm asking you to move. I'm asking you to minister right now, Father God. In the name that's above every name, Father God. Thank you, Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. Thank you, Heavenly Father God. Glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We thank you right now, Father God, for the mercies that you've shown on us, God. Glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, God. God's able to minister.
There is a healing for you. There is a healing in Jesus.
Just for a few moments as she's singing this, would you just lift your hands all over this house? Whatever the need is, my God. God is able to move. My God's able to minister.
Come to the table of mercy. There is a healing for you. There is a healing in Jesus. No matter what you're going through.
Yes, glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus.
Of mercy, there is a healing for you.
Yes, glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Be to God. Give God a great hand clap of praise this morning. God's good. Amen. God, in the name of Jesus, I pray, Father God, you'll continue to touch and continue to minister to each and every one that's in this sanctuary today, those that have joined us on live feed alike. God, I thank you for what you've done and what you're going to continue to do in our midst today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Give God another hand clap of praise this morning. Amen. Glory be to God. God is good. Amen. Amen. Again, so thank you so much for being here with us today. Amen. Over the last few Sunday mornings, or the last several Sunday mornings, prior to Easter Sunday, we started talking about, Jesus' life. Then we started talking about the death and the burial and the resurrection of Christ. Amen. Then we went further and we started talking about Pentecost. We talked about the events that took place between the Ascension and Pentecost Sunday. Amen? We talked about the fact that how Pentecost is not dead. Amen? Pentecost is not dead. I've had people to come to me and they'll say, what does Pentecost mean? That excites me more than anything else because I get to explain Pentecost. Amen? And it's wonderful. It's wonderful to understand. It's wonderful to talk about. Wonderful to hear. And over the last few days, being in a room with about 2,500 other pastors and ministers of the gospel around the world, start hearing and talking, them talking and telling about how that Pentecost is very much alive. Amen? Pentecost is very much alive. The Holy Spirit of God is still moving in hearts and lives around the world. Amen? We've been talking about that. Then we started talking about after Pentecost, we said, okay, the Holy Spirit's come, Pentecost has happened. Now what? We can't go back into the life of the way we used to have. Why? Because the New Testament church, where did they come from? They came from the Jews. They can't go back into their Jewish ways of life, their Jewish traditions. Some tried and they were saying, this don't work the same. I mean, it's not working the same. So we've been talking about, we've been discussing, and we've been having a conversation about, we started in the book of Acts, Acts chapter 3. Because Acts chapter 2 is when Pentecost takes place. There's in a upper room. And suddenly, there was a move of the Holy Spirit. Amen? And so we've talked about that. We discussed that. And we fast forward. We move ahead. And we start talking about what happens next. You know, this is about the same way it is with our lives with God. We get our lives straightened out. We get our lives, we get saved. And well, what do we do now? We can't go back to the status quo. We can't go back to doing what we used to do. We got to do something different. Well, Peter and John, they start walking, and I know I've told this, and I've told this, and I know it. I get it. I've told this. Quit telling the same thing. But it is amazing to me that Peter and John, they start going to the temple one day.
and the religious leaders of the day, they walked right past somebody that needed something from God. They walked right past the guy that was sitting right in the outskirts of the gate. And they walked right past him. Everybody's walking right past him. Some may have threw him a quarter. Some may have even threw a dollar. Some may have done something. But others walk past him and they ignore him just like everybody else has done. Well, Peter and John, they didn't. They stopped and they said, "Silver and gold have I none, but what I do have, I've given unto you." So I want to think about that particular phrase. What I do have, I give unto you. We must understand something, church. What we've got to give back to God. Everything I have does not belong to me. It does not belong to me. The $2.95 that's in my checking account did not belong to me. What I have is not mine. God has allowed me to put it into my account. God has allowed me to use it to buy lunch here in a few minutes. God has allowed me to use this to make automobile payments, to make life insurance payments, to pay bills, to do things with. But it belongs to God. It's not mine. God has just given it to me for me to be a steward of what God has given unto me. Amen? Before I get any further into this, how many got the text last night? Nobody. How many got the text from the church last night? Started off with, "Pastor Andy's home from General Assembly." Did y'all get that? Okay. Don't raise your hand on this one because I don't want to be embarrassed and I don't want to get my feelings hurt. How many read the whole, you ain't got to raise your hand. Don't raise your hand. How many read the whole text? I know one person did. They said, "Oh, you gave us homework." Somebody texted me last night and said, "I guess we need to bring lunch today. You gave us homework." I'm not going to tell you who he is, but his name is Dan Kennedy. But I want you to think about that phrase, what Peter and John said, "What I do have, I give unto you." Let me tell you something, church. Nothing we have belongs to us. The entirety of it belongs to God. God has given it to us for us to be stewards of what God has placed into our lives. And when we're good stewards of what God has placed into our lives, we are to use what God's given to us to help others around us. Amen? I got three. I'll be all right. Maybe by the end we'll get more. And so I've had somebody over the years. Okay, don't try to look around and figure out who it is because the person's not here. But I've had somebody over the years that they would call me up every so often or send me a text message and say, "Hey, I've got so-and-so that I know they need help with," we'll say, "power bill," just to make it easy and generalized for all of us. And they'll say, I'm taking up money for this particular individual." And I'll say, "Well, who is it?" Oh, I'm keeping that private." First of all, I'm going to just go ahead and tell you something. I understand confidentiality, but anyways, I'll digress off of that one. So we move forward. And so I'll start asking questions about what's going on, and they'll say, "That's none of your business. That's not biblical." And I will immediately say, "Thank you for calling. I'll pray about this, and we'll go forward," and I'll hang the phone up. Because I want you to understand something. It is biblical. And I'm fixing to show you where it's biblical. I've had over the years people to tell me, and they'll tell me, they'll say, "I have helped so-and-so. I have poured into this, and now I need you to help me." Let me enlighten you on something. That's not biblical either. Okay? You cannot, and don't look at me cross-eyed because I'm going to show you in Scripture. You cannot take your grocery money to pay somebody else's power bill and expect somebody else to put groceries on your table. You have got to take care. God has placed you to take care of your household and your family. And when you do that in the proper fashion, God will give you a surplus to help others in need. Amen? I may have three on that one. and some want to throw something at me because they're thinking I'm preaching heretic. But I'm going to tell you something that is scriptural, and I'm going to show you this, okay? Everything you have that's in your possession, your automobile, your home, the land you own, the money in your account, your check and your savings, your 401k, everything you have because God has allowed you to have it. Amen? I got more on that one than I did on anything else. However, you are to be good stewards of what God has placed in your possession. Amen? Does everybody agree with me on this? You have got to do the right thing as lined up with Scripture with what you have in order to help others in need. We talked in Sunday school this morning about how the church is to take care of the widows and widowers connected with our body. We are to take care of those in need connected with this body. Amen? We are to do that. On your tithe envelope, you will notice that there is a place that says CV Missions. One of the missions of this church is to take care of those that need help. Not a hand out, but a hand up in their time of need. Amen? We are to do that. I will go even further to state that this church has helped more than I would be able to give you a report to be able to tell you to help in the 9 years we've been here. It has blown me away the amount of benevolence that this church has helped those in need. How are we able to do that? Because we as a body are good stewards of what God has given to us. Amen? We have to be. That's your personal, and that's this church's finances. I'll even go one step further. I had a pastor tell me one time. He said, it's hard. I'm throwing it all on the table right now. This pastor said, it's hard to tell his church how much money is in the checking account because the moment he does that, people come out of the woodwork with power bills, water bills, and grocery bills and everything else that they're wanting to help with. But what they don't realize is the church has to take care of the finances of the church as well. I'll tell you on live feed. Don't tell Brother Emery I said this. I'll tell you on live feed, the assets of this church is over the $50,000 mark. Okay? When I came here, it was less than $7,000. Okay? People will say, oh, we got money. We can do. No. Wait. We also have bills that has to be paid. The bills of this. Look, I'm not talking on finance. I'm not preaching on tithing this morning, okay? Everybody is all stressing out already, ain't you? I'm not doing that. Our monthly bills are around $12,000, okay? So $50,000 don't seem like a whole lot anymore, does it? And it's not frivolous bills. We're not paying for any. Oh, I'm on live feed. I forgot. I was going to say something. I'll say it anyway. I don't really care. Had this guy tell me that he was getting going. I'm saying this as a joke, so don't anybody get. Everybody go ahead and get ready to laugh, okay? Ooh, let me put my glasses back on. See any objects thrown at me. Had this pastor come to me and he said, I got a manicure and a pedicure before I came to General Assembly. I said, ain't nobody touching my toes. They said, you'll love it. No, I won't. Ain't nobody touching my toes. So this church is not paying for me a manicure or pedicure. I said, that is a joke. Everybody laughing. There's not frivolous things that's going on. Part of the budget for this church is allocating money for benevolence ministries. Part of the budget of this church is allocating money for mission programs. We have a home for children. We have mission programs that we do overseas. We have these mission opportunities that we give, and God has blessed this church. Over the years, I have had businessmen from this community come to me, and they'll say, I'm so sorry to hear that your church is in so much debt. And I look at them and I'm like, what are you talking about? And they'll say, well, so-and-so came and told me that they left the church because you ran the church to debt. And I'll tell them, when I came here, the church had no indebtedness. Brother Emery, am I correct? We had zero indebtedness. Didn't have a house payment, mortgage, nothing. And to this day, we have no indebtedness. Hello? We paved the parking lot of this church and wrote a check for it. Done. We did not take a loan out. We paid $45,000 for all of this in phases. And we did that how? Because God blessed His church. So now you go back to, so that everybody will get up. Won't get so knots. Everybody's got knots all tied up. He's fixing to preach on tithing and offering. Everybody's got knots all tied up. So that we go back off of that to where everybody will get okay. What you've got to understand is Peter and John, as they got to the temple, they might could have opened their wallet. I left cash in my wallet just for this reason. They might could have opened their wallet and pulled some cash out. Okay? They might would have had a 10. I went into Sister Carrie's wallet and got all this money out. Just don't tell her I did it. Man, I got more. You had more 20s than I thought you had. Y'all, I'm kidding. Man, I didn't get none of this out of her wallet. I got this out of squirrel. Does anybody know what squirrel is? Everybody know what squirrel is? Squirrel is when you squirrel away cash for a rainy day. 2, 4, 6. Man, I ain't counting this. Somebody will rob me after church. I better put that back up. Your husband ain't here, so I ain't got to worry about him robbing me. You can tell him I said that too. Stan, you better stay away from me. The point, I'm making a point here. Peter and John could have pulled their wallet out and they might would have had cash on them. Okay? They might would have had cash on them. But that's not what the purpose that they did. They said, this is what they were saying, and I said this a few weeks ago. They could have handed the dude a $20 bill. He could have gotten him a little self up. Somebody helped him get up. They could have went down to McDonald's and had lunch. Now what do they have? Nothing. But Peter and John said, what I do have is what you really truly need. Are you seeing the difference? What we've got to realize and understand is God has given us more than an automobile, more than a house, more than land, more than property, more than cash. God has given us something that we are supposed to bestow on others. But instead, we want to clam things down and don't get near me. Your sinful nature will rub off on me. Don't get near me. Church, we are supposed to be the people that is going out in the highways and byways and bidding people to come to the house of God. Amen? We're supposed to be doing these things. And how do we do this? By going and helping people in their time of need. That does not mean just giving cash. I've heard too many times people will say, just throw cash at the situation. Look, if you want to throw cash at anybody, I'll gladly allow you to throw cash at me. I'll be okay with that. But what happens is once cash is gone, it's gone, right? Is everybody with me on that one? So I want you to take a look at something. And what I'm fixing to read, everybody has always referred to this as money. Yes, money is involved. But I need you to get a hold of something, is once God has touched your life, once God has rearranged and changed your life, everything else, including your finances, will get in order. Okay? I need you to hear me. I've had people, look, 26 years of pastoral, 30 years of preaching the gospel, I have had countless number of people. They'll come to me. My finances are in disarray. I don't know what I'm going to do. Don't know what's going to happen. And 90% of the time, if I say, are you paying your tithes and offering? They'll respond with no. And I promise you, that's where the start of the problem is at. But it does not stop at just finances. It goes further than that. And that's what I want to talk about. Take a look at our first passage of Scripture. It's found in Acts chapter 4. Acts chapter 4, starting in verse 32. Acts chapter 4, starting in verse 32. Peter and John been in prison. They're out of prison. They ran. They found the church. They started talking about, telling the church what's going on. The Holy Spirit of God fell. The place was shaken. They received boldness. Now here's where we're at. Because you can look at the verse right above that. Verse 31, what does it say? Received boldness. Now look at where we're at. Now the full number of those who believed were of one heart and soul. No one said that any of the things that belonged to him were his own, but they had everything in common. And with great power, the apostles were giving their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And with great grace was upon all of them. There was not a needy person among them. For as many who were as owners of land or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold and laid it at the apostles' feet. And it was distributed to each as any had need. Thus Joseph, who was also called by the apostles Barnabas, which means son of encouragement, a Levite, a native of Cyprus, sold a field that belonged to him, brought the money, and laid it at the apostles' feet. What you must understand and realize is that the New Testament church, this is the foundation of the New Testament church, is the same group of people that came out of the upper room. And in the upper room on Acts chapter 2, it says that they was in one mind, one accord, one place. They was all praying together as one group of people. They did not have divisions. There was no, oh, I'm over here, oh, I'm over here, I'm over here, I'm over here. No, they was one group of people. And this is what the New Testament church has been built upon. It is built upon unity. Amen? And so we find here in the New Testament church, as they are continuing to grow, the church has one mind, one heart, and one soul. The order of the Greek sentence says the one heart, one soul, they were one. In other words, the person's whole being was one with other believers. They was complete and they was total in oneness and in unity. One accord, one in harmony, and one in love. They was not trying to pull over here, and they wasn't trying to pull over here. They was one group of people, and they had one thing that they was trying to do, and that was to get a hold to the hand of God. There was nobody trying to pull to this way or to this way. They was in unity moving forward with God. Remember, there were multitudes, thousands of believers at this time. How could a world, could one body be one and achieve one heart, one soul, one mind, become unified on one thing together as one group of people? We'll take a look back at verse 32. Verse 32 of Acts chapter 4. The early believers gave their heart, their souls, and everything they had to the Lordship and the mission of Jesus Christ. I'll have people all the time, they'll argue with me. They ain't getting an argument out of me, but they'll argue with me and say that tithes and offerings is not in the New Testament church. We're not supposed to give that to the New Testament church. I don't find that in scriptures anywhere. Amen? I'll tell them, you know, if you really want to get down to the nuts and bolts of it, go back and read Acts chapter 4. Because what they did was they sold everything that they had extra and said, I'm giving it to the church. So let's just use this for example. If one of them had 10 acres of land and they was farming on 5 acres, had their house on the same 5 acres, and the other 5 acres was sitting and being obsolete. You know what they did? They sold the 5 acres. They kept the 5 acres they was using where their farm and their house was at, but the other 5 acres had pine trees on it and was sitting there being wasted. You know what they did? They sold it. Now, nowhere do you find, I need you to hear what I'm saying, nowhere in scriptures does it say that they sold the 5 acres of land for $1,000 and they was required to give the entire $1,000 to the church. That's not there. Brother Andy, that's what they did. I know that's what they did. But is there a requirement of that? No. They gave it of their own free accord. Now you also need to understand, they did not give what was necessary to take care of their own family. Many times people will read these passages of Scripture, especially when you move over into Acts chapter 5. Boy, that's a powerful one right there. But you'll move over into Acts chapter 5 and people will state, oh, they gave and now they depended on the church for their own groceries. That's not what was said. They had the sufficient means to take care of their own household of faith, but they also gave to the body, to the apostles, that took care of those that needed. If you look back into Jewish customs and traditions, you look back at history, you look back at history books, you will not find these things. There's no, and I'm not knocking anybody that's on it, so don't think about this, okay? Don't think I'm doing it. You're not going to find food stamps. You're not going to find that. You're not going to find Medicaid. You're not going to find welfare. You're not going to find none of these things in the New Testament, in the beginning of the New Testament church. Why? Because the church took care of those that was of the household of faith. If you was a part of the family of God, you were taken care of. So what does that mean about somebody that was outside the household of faith? The Bible says they took care of everyone who had need in the church body. Do y'all hear what I'm saying? Okay? This does not mean that they did not take care of somebody that was outside of the church, but they took care of the church body first. You cannot, if I give somebody everything I've got and I do not take care of my family, then I'm going against the Scripture. The Bible tells me that Sister Carrie and Miss Katie, wherever she's at, upstairs, nursery, they are my responsibility. Are y'all hearing me? Who's mad at me yet? Okay. Live feed, if you're mad at me. What we must realize and understand is Sister Carrie and Miss Katie and Oreo and Sissy too, they're my responsibility. I have to take care of them. The Bible plainly tells me that. We have to take care of one another. We give to this church so that this church can take care of the household of faith. And then we also help outside of this body. Amen? This is a biblical mandate. This is told to us throughout Scripture that we are to take care of our body of believers. Why did they do these things? Why did they enact that they wanted to make sure that they sold their possessions, the extra things that they did not need? Why did they do that? They did this because they believed, they truly believed that Jesus Christ had died for their sins. They believed that He had risen from the dead. They believed that He had been exalted to the right hand of the Father. They believed that they had been commissioned to go forth, reaching out to help those in need, and they was to return and reward believers for being faithful to the mission of the church. The early church gave above and beyond. the demand to love and to share things. This is not something that they could just overlook. This was something that was required at that time. And we should understand that today. Why? Because the believers of that day, they didn't trust in riches. I've already showed y'all cash. And then I made mention that somebody could steal that. Just because you got cash doesn't mean it's there. How many of you? You ain't got to raise your hand. How many of you, when the stock markets crashed several years ago, you had 401ks, you had savings account, they lost a lot of money. Why? Because those things are tied to, in some instances, they're tied to the stock market. I know somebody, an individual that she lost in one day. She looked at her 401k, the next day she had lost $50,000. I don't know about you, but wasn't as bad as the second day she lost 75, but you know what I mean. That's a lot. When we put our trust and our dependence on the stock market, what's going to happen? It's going to fail us. We put our dependence on God, He'll never fail you. When you put your dependence on riches, when you put your dependence on others, you put your position, your dependence on possessions, on things, when you lay up and store up wealth, those things will fail you. God will never fail you. The early church believed in the Lordship of Jesus Christ. They believed in the eternal, in the inheritance of eternal life. They believed in being rewarded for the faithfulness to Christ. They believed in denying of self. They believed in forsaking all for Christ, loving others sacrificially, and the ownership of God. The early church believed. I know what time it is. Give me just a few moments and then we're going to close. I knew there's no way I was going to get through these 10 pages. I'm only on page 3, so. The early church, and I'm going to tell you something, this is what we've got to get back to. The early church believed and put their dependence on God. Matthew 6:33, seek you first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all the things will be added unto you. I said just a few days ago, standing right down here in the cemetery at a graveside service, I'm glad that I have my relationship with my Heavenly Father, and I know that He is going to take care of me. Amen? God has got us in the palm of His hand. We can trust in God. The early church believed that they were on earth to serve Christ and were being blessed with material possessions to help others. Let me throw this one in. Let me interject this. How long have we had that blue car? Years? Man, that's a long time. That car still runs good, don't it? It still kicks. Did you tell me yes, ma'am? And it's, glory to God, it's paid for. Hallelujah. That was the best part. But I remember the Sunday after we bought that car. People came to church. They seen that brand new car sitting in the driveway. It wasn't this church. I've only been here 9 years. This is 13 years ago. People came, did they not? People came. Well, we must be paying the pastor way too much money if he'd be able to buy himself a brand new car. I politely told them very quick, like and in a hurry. I worked full-time at the funeral home at that time. Funeral home paid for that car. Hallelujah. Me and Sister Carrie have been very frugal in what we have. We use what we have for the glory of God. We do what we're going to do for the benefits of the kingdom of God. Amen. And I'm going to tell you something. If we all do that, God's going to take care of us. God's got us. I don't have to worry. I don't know, probably 20-plus years. I know me and Sister Carrie's been married for 21 years. Yes, she's put up with me that long. Not one time have we had to figure out, well, I wonder where groceries is going to come at for tomorrow. They might not have been much groceries in the house, but we had something to eat. We had a bologna sandwich, hallelujah. Peanut butter and jelly is good. Not one time have we tried to figure out, oh Lord, what are we going to do next? It got tough. It got real tough. But God's always taking care of us. Proverbs tells us, I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging for bread. If we do what God's called us to do, God's going to take care of his people. Amen? Would you stand all over this house? Church, I need you to realize something. And I hope I can get to this next Sunday. One of the greatest sins of the New Testament church was keeping. Keeping back from God. Keeping back from God. There was a time I was getting dressed and I was getting ready to go to a revival service. Some of you have heard this story, some of you haven't. I was getting ready and I was fixing to go to a revival service. I walked through the living room and I told Sister Kit, she don't let me have the checkbook. My handwriting's awful. Walked through and I told Sister Carrie, I said, hey, can you write an offering check for tonight? $10. The checking account had about 12, this is not joke, had about $12 in the checking account that day. I told her, I said, can you write a check for about $10 for the offering for tonight? I'm sure in the back of her mind, she's looking at me, you have lost your ever-loving mind. The whole time she's getting that checkbook out of her purse. Didn't hesitate. She starts writing that check. She wrote it to the church I was going to for the revival service. She writes $10. She signs her name to it. She writes in the memo field, offering. I go to the office. I'm finishing getting ready. God tells me, he says, hey, out of that squirrel can you got, how about getting $100 out for offering tonight? I said, God, she's already wrote a check. He said, I know that. How about getting $100 out of squirrel and giving that in? I said, no, sir. You've lost your mind. That's fun telling God that. What's not fun is what happens next. He gets on to you. I went over there and I opened up the squirrel can. And I pulled out what was in there. And it went 2, 4, 6, 8, 1. And there was nothing left in the squirrel. The can only had $100 in it. And I said, God, that's all I got. I said, the checking account has $12 and she is writing a check for 10. That means $2. He says, I know. I go back through and I told her, I said, don't worry about the $10 check. And the moment I said that, God said, I didn't tell you to do that. I snatched that $10 check out of her hand. I said, me and God's going to have a conversation in the car on the way back or on the way there. I'll be back. I think she giggled at me as I was going out the door. I had $110 in my shirt pocket I'm taking to this revival service, and now I have $2 left in my account. Let me tell you something up front. We had a full tank of gas. We had groceries in the house. All of the bills were paid. It wasn't that I was taking grocery money. I was actually getting my paycheck in 3 days. But it sort of makes you feel weird when you're like that, right? Yeah, if you've never been there, this is one of those times that you're like, hey. I get to the revival service, Brother Art. This particular church, they took up the offering. They kept playing the piano. They was waiting for the guys to count the offering at the back. And they said, praise God, Pastor, we got $117 in. I was not happy. I started to stand up and say, the rest of y'all only gave 7. But I didn't. The evangelist knows me. He was sitting straight across the aisle from me, and he looked at me and he said, "Thank you." I had no idea what was going on financially in his life, but he needed that $100. I was fixing to get my paycheck, and you got to remember, I was working in a funeral home at the time. I was making really good money. It was my second paycheck for the month. All of our bills was paid at the first of the month. The second paycheck of the month was our money. I was getting paid good money at the funeral home, and this is our eating out money. This is our money. This was good money. This was icing on the cake. I went to the mailbox the next day, and there was a $200 check in the mailbox. God will always take care of His people. Do you understand me? You have got to make sure that you are stewards of what God has given to you, and God will take care of you. Amen? Would you bow your heads? Dear Heavenly Father, as we come to you today, God, I want to thank you for the blessings that you've given us. Father, I want to thank you for this great opportunity you've allowed us to come into your house to worship and praise you. Father, today I pray that you'll help us not to keep anything back from you. Our heart, our mind, our souls, everything that we have, God, we owe it all to you. And Father, I thank you for it, and I praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. Live Feed, thank you so much for joining with us. Join us back Wednesday, 6:30. May God bless you.